Hey, it's Hawk. I'm gonna turn a little light on here. It's probably a little dark. I don't know, maybe that helps. Look, I'm sorry I should have posted something a few days ago. I'm happy to report, however, that two things, three things have happened to brighten my mood a bit. One, it's Olympics. It's Olympics time. And anybody that's followed my regular channel knows that I'm an Olympic, fanatic. I love when the Olympics come around, whether it's the Winter Olympics or the Summer Olympics. Now I'm old enough, to remember quite a few of them, and some of my memories of past Olympics are just, ingrained in my memory banks. I think the first Olympics that I really was, I guess old enough to absorb, something from, and more importantly, really, paid much attention to, was probably the Summer Olympics of in Mexico, 1968. And some of my memories are a little foggy, but I remember some of the boxing. This is when I still cared about boxing. That's been a while. But also, of course, there was the unbelievable, long jump by Bob Beamon that still stands out in my memory. He had eclipsed the previous record by, I don't know what it was, something like more than 2 feet. And this in a sport, like most sports, where new world records are usually set in, very small increments, a tenth of a second, a couple of centimeters or, an inch. Now, of course, Mexico City Games were, held at a higher altitude than most previous Summer Olympics. I think Mexico City being kind of like Denver, like over a mile high, in altitude. So that the lighter air, certainly aided some of the records that were set in the 68 Olympics. Still, even even with accommodating, that or any other factors like wind assistance, for instance, Bob Beamon's record of, I think it was 29 feet 2 inches or something, is to this day the second longest long jump in Olympic history, if I am not mistaken. And at any rate, so there were some other, of course, I remember the figure skating. I'm a big figure skating fan, generally around the Olympics. And of course, who could forget, the Black Power salute that, who were the athletes? Carlos and Tommy. Again, this was in the summer of '68 when so much was happening. So anyway, bottom line is, I'm watching the Winter Olympics. Pretty much taping everything that's on in the afternoon and in the evening. Unlike previous years, back in the day, back in the 80s, the 90s, whatever, when Olympics would come on, there'd be like four or five different networks or channels, I should say, that would cover the Olympics. And I guess, to a certain extent, a little bit of that is still going on. And if you want to catch, like in real time, some of the events that are unfolding and not have to wait until, they basically package at least the highlights for prime time. You used to be able to go to some of these channels and watch, an entire competition, for instance, including all of the, the also-rans, if you will, the folks that, don't make it through the qualifying rounds or don't make it, you know, in the top one or two categories of figure skaters. And I used to tape all of that. And back in the day, before everything was digital, I would set my VCR and record all of this, and then I would make separate edited tapes where, I mean, I remember, I still have it somewhere. I think it's the 84 Sarajevo Olympics, one of my all-time favorite Olympics, by the way, where I had a highlight tape of all the greatest moments of the figure skating, Torvald and Dean, of course, being the highlight there. But also, I think that was the Olympics, if I'm not mistaken, I think that was the Olympics where Brian Boitano won his gold medal. It was a great, 84 was a great Olympics. And I'm not, don't hold me to that, Brian Boitano. I think Scott Hamilton won it in, was it 88? I don't know. You know, you get old, these, the past is kind of, becomes a fog. At any rate, I would make a highlight tape of all the greatest moments, and then I would make a lowlight tape of like all the, you know, crazy spills and falls, and then I would set that to music. And, you know, one of the things I really miss, when ABC used to cover the Olympics, they would end their Olympics coverage on the last day after the final closing ceremonies with like a highlight reel of, you know, the top moments of the Olympics set to Beethoven's Ode to Joy. And I look forward to that every year. And it's been a long time since, you know, well, now NBC has done anything like that at the end, and it's a shame. At any rate, so that has really lightened my mood. One, I'm not watching MSNBC and, you know, CNN and absorbing myself hour after hour with the news of the day, because that, well, you know how I feel. But I'm also trying to get my life back on track in some other ways. As many of you have seen me, you know, time after time, I'm wearing my oxygen because I just couldn't seem to wean myself off of it. I'm at the point now where, you know, I'm almost afraid to sleep without it. And even my doctor, at least the last time I went to see him months ago, told me it was probably a good idea to wear it at night now. Because I guess, you know, when you're laying down, your lungs are weaker than they are when you're sitting upright or standing upright. At any rate, a year ago, I almost never wore my oxygen unless I was, you know, kind of under the weather. And it was about a year ago or so, maybe a little more than a year ago, that I took to starting wearing my oxygen at night. And before you knew it, that became like a routine that I never varied from. And before you knew it, I started wearing the oxygen a little longer into the morning, because, you know, at first I would take it off pretty much as quickly as I got out of bed and at least made it to the living room. And I found myself getting to the point where I didn't feel like I could take it off yet. One thing led to another. And before you knew it, I was wearing oxygen at times all day long. The only time I would take it off is if I had to go to the store or I had to leave the house, in which case I would take my portable oxygen. But because I don't like to be seen with it, you know, I would just bring it with me, and I might wear it in the car, but as soon as I got out of the car, of course. At any rate, there's no denying the fact that the more you wear your oxygen, the more you're using your oxygen, the weaker your lungs become. It's just, you know, I've been told that. Even many of my viewers who have been kind enough to leave helpful comments for me, you know, they have, from their own, you know, family experiences or whatever, have informed me of that fact. And so finally, earlier this week, a few days ago, I determined that, you know what, I have got to reverse this. I mean, I have big plans for myself. I don't want to go away real quick. So I'm trying to wean myself from oxygen. This is maybe the third day where, I'm surprised how well I'm doing, actually. I kind of had a setback yesterday. I wore it a little bit more during the day yesterday. But the day before yesterday, the first really full day, I took it off very early in the morning. And by afternoon, I felt, amazingly better than I normally do. And I even managed to go down to the basement without wearing it. And in fact, while I took my portable with me, I never used it when I was down there. And I had to do a little bit of laundry. I just had to take a load and put it in the washer and take the load that was in the washer, put it in the dryer, take the clothes that were in the dryer out and hang them up. And at any rate, and my big problem is coming up the stairs and doing the physical labor of picking up the clothes and pulling them out of the, the appliance. At any rate, so today I took my oxygen off shortly after I woke up and took my breathing treatment, as I always do, had my cup of coffee, and took a little bit of my medicine, and I went down the basement, and this time I thought I'd be brave. Now, I'm not stupid. I always have my cell phone with me, and of course I had my rescue inhaler with me. But I went down to the basement. I was able to do all of that. I didn't take my portable with me. I was not only able to do everything without being totally out of breath, but I was able to come up the stairs carrying an armload of clothes. I think I had about 5 pair of jeans and some underwear and socks. And so I had a pretty good full load. I got to the living room. I set it down. Sat down for a few minutes to kind of catch my breath, and then I went in my room and hung everything up. I went to, the day before yesterday, another good example. Like I said, I was feeling good all day. My friend Dustin, I drove to Warren and picked him up and brought him back over here. We watched the Cavs game. Now, the Cavs, of course, just made this big trade, multiple trades, kind of really redid their roster, if you will. At any rate, so they had a big game with Boston that afternoon, and so Dustin and I watched that game together. It's really the first game we've seen together here in some time. And, I brought my portable along with me when I went to pick him up and everything, but I didn't need it. And I told him how good I was feeling. Now, by the time I took him home, because, of course, he stayed for the game, and then after the game, we watched some of the Olympics together. And so I didn't get him home. I think we left here about 1 a.m. It's about a 17-mile drive. So now, normally, I would have taken my oxygen, and at any rate, so we get in the car, and I'm backing out of the driveway, and I realize, one, I forgot to bring my oxygen. I left it in the house. And two, I didn't even have my inhaler. And by this time, I'm down at the end of my street. Now, I should have probably turned around and come back. But I didn't. I said, the heck with it. I've been feeling good today. Let's go for it. So I drove them all the way to Warren. On the way back, I had to stop at the store. Well, I stopped at a gas station. I love these donuts in the morning, and I don't get them very often. But, it's easier than making a full breakfast once in a while. So I did stop in, and I went in, and you have to walk a little ways into the store to get to the donuts, and you have to reach into the cabinet and, put them in a container. And by the time I got to the desk, I was a little out of breath. And so much so that I found myself kind of leaning on the counter. And, and I paid for the donuts, and I kind of I walked to the door. And I kind of stood there for a moment trying to catch my breath, but it just didn't seem to help too much. And now normally what I would have done, casually but very, very slowly, because the faster you walk, the more oxygen you seem to use. So I kind of walked very slow, very small steps, kind of like an old man. And I would normally get to my car and calmly put my oxygen on and, return to normal before I would put my car in gear and drive away. But I didn't have any of those options. I didn't even have my inhaler. And so I sat there and I just tried some breathing exercises. And it took me about 2 minutes to where I felt, I think I'm going to be okay. I'm fine. And I made it all the way home, no problem. So at any rate, like I say, today I'm feeling very good. I feel so good that I feel like I could grab my jacket and attempt to walk around the block, with my oxygen in tow, but not on. Now, I feel like I could do that, but the little voice in my head tells me, no, you're not ready for that. Now, one of the reasons why I think I'm seeing this improvement, and fa faster, I think, than I had thought, is because it's been warming up a little bit. Last 3 days, well, yesterday was kind of a cold one again. We had a cold snap. But day before yesterday, it got up to about 44 degrees, 45 degrees. Today, it's about 40 degrees. And I understand it's supposed to go up to as high as 50 degrees, 50, 52 degrees, twice this week. I think I don't know if it's tomorrow and Thursday or Thursday and Friday. And so as the weather warms up, it does really help me. Now, my goal here is to get to the point where I can, quite literally walk around the block. Now, that would be just shy of a half mile. I don't think quite a half mile to walk around the block. It's a pretty big block. And one part of it is downhill. The rest of it is not much of a grade, really. So I would walk down, my street. Across would be Jones Street, up the long straightaway, and then onto my street here, about where I'm about the fourth house, and so I'm going to wait until one of those 50 degree days. I think I'm going to try to take my oxygen with me. What would be helpful is if I had one of those. I saw one advertised. I think they're about $20 or so. There are these. It's a cane. But it's a folding chair. It's like a three-legged stool, if you will. You can use it as a cane, and then if you press down on it, there's like this little round seat, and it becomes like a three-legged stool, and you can just stop wherever you are and sit on it. And that's, it sounds kind of silly, and I don't know how heavy the damn thing is, but it would be ideal for my purposes because, I find myself in that situation a lot. Where I've got, a certain distance to walk, and I'm way too tired to walk the full distance that I need to go. And there's often not a place to sit down, So I'll have to consider getting one. Now, I'm really trying to pay down my debts here. I've got quite a ways to go. I mean, I've got student loan debt that, I never really filled everybody in on this. I was, told that I would have this rather expensive tax liability if my student loan were forgiven. Because I'm on disability, I was eligible to have it forgiven. However, the amount of money that you owe becomes considered a income, and it goes, you have to list it on your income tax return as income. And in my case, we're talking about almost $13,000. It's about $12,000 that I still had left on my student loans, at the time I went on disability. And now I tell you, that's a sizable amount of money to have to pay. And but apparently, I didn't have to pay it. I didn't have to show it on my income tax yet. I'm on a I don't know how they worded it, but as I understand it, once they kind of approved me, which they did, they sent me a letter saying that, it had been approved. There is a forget now, but I think it's a 2-year window where basically they check to see whether or not your disability is going to go away, or if you're going to do something else that suddenly makes you not eligible for this forgiveness. But after that 2 years, then you have to claim it. And once I have to claim it on my income tax, you know, I have to pay the full liability. And I think I don't know for a fact exactly what it's going to be, but the best estimate I came up with was somewhere between about $2,200 to $2,600, thereabout. That's a lot of money to come up with. And they don't give you like 6 months to pay it, or, you know, a payment plan. You got to pay it up front, you know, with your income tax. So anyway, I know that is in my future. And at any rate, I'm trying to pay down my credit card debt and my PayPal account, which is something else. A few things that I bought for my trip or whatever, you know, I purchased on PayPal, and, you know, for 6 months, they don't charge you any interest. And so I didn't pay it back as fast as I've been paying on my credit cards, because those are higher interest. Now the PayPal account has charged me interest. And so I have to make, you know, at least minimum payments. And the way I was taught to do this is you take your, you know, your highest interest card and you pay that down first. So I am 2 weeks away from paying that down to zero, in which case I am going to call and cancel that credit card. 2 weeks away from making that payment. But that leaves two others that are not paid down, and the PayPal account. And so, you know, I'm working on it. I mean, the goal is to pay them all off and use them only in emergencies. And like I say, between the trip and a few other things that had come up, you know, I ended up maxing those cards. And I don't have real high credit availability like some people, you know. But at any rate, I have been every penny I get that doesn't have to be spent on something else, you know, is spent on these cards. I don't usually pay the minimum balance on one. I pay way over. And, you know, there's an attempt to pay these off as quickly as possible. So that's the goal. So knowing that with my next payment, I'm going to pay one off is another thing that lightens my mood. So anyway, I just wanted to kind of give you that rundown of what's been going on. Now, I have still been paying somewhat attention to, you know, all this craziness going on with the Trump administration and, you know, the whole, I mean, really, it is unbelievable that there are so many people within the Trump administration that can't pass a simple background check. But that shouldn't surprise anybody, because let's face it, Donald Trump certainly couldn't. So it shouldn't be any surprise that his son-in-law, you know, or many of his top aides can't either. The fact is, they're all, I'll tell you what worries me, you know, is it's not even the idea that they're being blackmailed. It's the idea that they're willingly funneling, you know, national secrets to, well, Kushner, China, because of how, you know, they're financing, you know, his building on Park Avenue, or, you know, or Trump and his family, because of all of the, you know, the money that they're getting, you know, from different Russian and Russian satellite oligarchs. So anyway, I have a feeling that however the Trump administration ends, whatever it is that brings it to an end, whether it's an election or whether it's an impeachment or whether it's a resignation, whatever it is, I have very few doubts that the next administration will be Democrat, and I have very few doubts that Democrats will probably be in control of Congress. Senate's a little iffy, but I think there's a very strong likelihood that after the Trump administration, within the first year of a new administration, we will see some real changes as to the requirements of meeting certain background status requirements. And I just think that there the days where you can where the president can just, you know, waive the requirements, or they can just you know, basically not be held accountable, are going to be over. I think they're going to strengthen that, along with some other things that need to be strengthened from a national security standpoint, as far as I'm saying. But at any rate, so I'm still paying attention to all of that. But, you know, really, thank God the Olympics are on, and I'm kind of eating a lot of it up. We don't do as well medal-wise, obviously, as we do in the Summer Olympics. We don't excel at as many sports in comparison as we do in the summer. But, you know, some of the sports I enjoy watching, even if the United States doesn't do as well. I've always enjoyed the figure skating. I always seem to find at least some skaters that I enjoy watching. And I love all the snowboarding. Even though personally I'm a skier, I love all the alpine events, really, and the aerials, the slope side was fun. Americans took gold in both events. Now, of course, there's the half pipe events. Sean White just looked outstanding for a guy that's been around for quite a while. And so I'm just eating all of that up. But, you know, I mean, really, if there was nothing else on, it wouldn't matter. I'd watch curling. I love the Olympics. I just love the whole thing about it. I love hearing about what some of these people have done to get there. Some of the most inspiring stories I've ever, you know, come across have come from some of these athletes, you know, that have competed or at least sought to compete in the Olympics. This is a good way to remind you that I have a couple of videos on that subject up on my main channel. One is about Elena Mukina, a Russian gymnast, which is also, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the most watched video I've ever done on either channel. Unfortunately, it was never eligible for revenue sharing, so I don't get any money for it because I used a lot of footage, you know, that obviously I don't own. But it's if you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. And of course, I did a video also about a distance runner. Glenn Cunningham, whose life story is very inspiring as well. I may have to do another one. There are so many athletes that come to mind of people that, you know, whose story, regardless of how they did or fared in the Olympics, when you see what they overcame in their lives, you know, just to have that moment, it is just incredible. There's so many stories. Anyway, so I'm basking in all of that. I'm feeling pretty good. Hopefully getting better and stronger. We'll see. So anyway, I'm going to let you go. I thank you very much for watching. And, you know, it's nice to talk about something other than politics once in a while, but don't quit resisting. There are some special elections coming up even as we speak. So if you're one of the folks that have a chance to vote, whether it's this week, next month, or come November, you know what we got to do. Thanks again for watching. I will see you again real soon.